Hello and welcome to Learn Linux TV. In today's video, I have a very fun project for you guys. What we're going to do is build our very own desktop in the cloud. Now, that might seem like a very crazy idea, but you'd be surprised. Having your very own cloud desktop can be incredibly useful. And that's especially true nowadays because as more and more people work from home, then having your very own desktop in the cloud can be something that'll be an amazing benefit to a lot of people. So what we'll do is set up the server, then we'll install the desktop environment. After we do that, we'll connect to that desktop environment from our local workstation. And I'm also going to show you how to add some default security as well, because any instance that's public facing is open to public scrutiny. So security becomes even more important with a project like this. So what I'll do is give you some default security measures that you can implement to help better secure your instance. Now, when I say default security, the reason why I phrase it that way is because security is really important and it never really stops. So what you'll end up with is a great starting point, but I do recommend that you keep researching security to better secure your instance even beyond what I show you in this video, because you never know. There's always something new coming out, and it's very important to protect our servers as best we can. So I'm very excited to get started. So you know what? Let's do exactly that. Let's get started with building our cloud desktop. So let's get started. What I've done on my end is I've already created a Linux server that will be the focus for today's video. I haven't configured it quite yet, but I have created it, and what you're seeing right here is a server that has 4 GB of RAM as well as 2 CPU cores. And when it comes to a cloud desktop, that's probably the minimum that I would recommend. If you think about it, you'll probably be running a web browser within your remote session, and web browsers can use quite a bit of memory nowadays. So we definitely want to make sure that we have enough memory for desktop-related applications, which sometimes can be a little bit more demanding than server applications. You could absolutely go higher than 4 GB of RAM, but it might be better to start at 4 GB of RAM, just see how it works, and if it's slow or not responding as fast as you would like, then at that point, maybe you might want to upgrade your instance to a higher instance type. Now, even though I've created the server here on Linode, this particular video is not specific to Linode. I just wanted to mention a few things about the server that I've created, but it really doesn't matter where you create the server. I'm going to be using Ubuntu in my case, but other than that, there's nothing specific. So let's go ahead and switch to a terminal. We'll connect to this instance, and then we'll get started. So I'll type SSH, and then the username of the user on the remote end, and then I'll paste in the IP address. And there's the IP address for my cloud desktop right there. So I'll press enter. And now we're connected. Now notice that it says 0 updates are available. Off camera, I went ahead and installed all of the available updates, so I have that part already taken care of. Now before we go any further, I just want to mention that I have a video on this channel already that walks you through some of the minimal things that you should always do anytime you set up a new Linux server. That video will walk you through doing things such as creating a non-root user for yourself, securing SSH, and also setting the host name. Now, I'm not going to repeat any of that in this video. If you don't already know how to perform those specific tasks, then I'll leave a card for that video right about here, and you can check out that video. Just do everything in that video, just some minimal things that you should do. Once you have that done, you could come back here and we'll continue along. But going forward, I'm going to assume that you've already taken care of everything that was mentioned in that video. Now, another thing that I'm going to show you that's going to help you with security before we actually install the desktop packages is how to set up unattended upgrades. Unattended upgrades will keep our server up to date even after the initial update that we should have already done by now, so that way we could rest easy knowing that overnight the server will update itself, and that'll help keep it secure. And to do that, what I'll do is run sudo apt install. And the package that we'll need to install is unattended-upgrades. It might be installed for you already, but let's see. And it looks like it's already installed. So all we have to do is configure unattended upgrades because we already have it installed in our system. If you don't have it installed on your end, then just run that command that I just gave you, and that'll make sure that you have it available. So what we'll do next is change directory into /etc/apt, /apt.conf.d. And we have quite a few files here, but there's only a few files that we'll need to edit. So what I'll do is run sudo nano, and the file that we're going to start with is 50 unattended upgrades. There's going to be several changes that we'll need to make inside this file. So what we'll do is scroll down, and here's the first option right here. What this is going to do for us is it's going to instruct the server to reboot automatically anytime there's upgrades. So what we'll do is uncomment this line right here, then we'll go all the way here to the end, and we'll set that to true. This option right here is already set to true, but we will uncomment that. And the value of this option is if you accidentally leave a session open, then it'll still reboot. Not all updates require a reboot, but a lot of them do. And if a reboot is required, then this will make sure that the server definitely reboots. Now let's scroll down a little bit further. And actually it's right here. We want to uncomment this line right here to set the reboot time. Now I'm going to leave it at 2 a.m, but you could go ahead and change this to whatever time you are absolutely not going to be using this particular server, so that way it's not rebooting in the middle of something that you might be doing. Anyway, that's the last change that I'll make right here, so I'll save the file and close out. Now the next file that we're going to possibly edit is 20 auto upgrades. And it's quite a bit smaller. We want to make sure that both of these are set to 1. You can see the value of 1 on each line towards the right-hand side, and that's what we want. It's already configured the way that we need it to be. So there's nothing that we need to do here, but if this file does not have a 1 for these two lines right here, you'll need to update that. Anyway, I'll just close out of the file, and unattended upgrades is all set and ready to go. Now the next thing that we're going to do is set up CrowdSec. This is not required, it's just an additional piece of security. It's always a good thing to have. And what CrowdSec will do for us is it'll actually watch the logs and block people that are trying to get into our server, you know, maybe threat actors or somebody trying to break in. CrowdSec will actually monitor things and will also benefit from knowledge from other servers that have CrowdSec installed as well. If another server out there in the wild has CrowdSec installed and a threat actor tries to break in, then CrowdSec will keep track of that IP address and also inform all the other CrowdSec installations about that IP and inform the other servers to block that IP as well. And installing it is very easy to do. We'll first make sure that we have curl installed. We could do that by typing which and then curl. In my case, I actually have that installed already. If I didn't, I could run sudo apt install curl just like that. And that'll help get curl installed on the system. But since I already have it, I'll skip that step. Anyway, I'll type curl, -s, and then I'll type the URL. And then I'll use the pipe symbol to redirect the output of that particular command to sudo bash. Now you should always check these commands in these scripts before you run them. I've already done that off camera. But anytime you're running a script from the internet, you should basically take a look at that first. But since I've already done that, I'll just press enter. And now the repository for CrowdSec has been installed on our server. The next command that we're going to run is sudo apt install, and then CrowdSec. I'll press enter. And there we go. Now we have CrowdSec installed, but we also need another component of CrowdSec installed, which is known as a bouncer. Basically, a short summary is that CrowdSec notices anytime someone tries to break into the server, and the bouncer is what actually does something about that if a threat has been detected. Without a bouncer, then CrowdSec will still notice things happening, but nothing will be done about it. We need the bouncer to actually take action. Now, I have a full video on CrowdSec if you want to check that out and learn even more about CrowdSec. I'm just summarizing it here, but let's go ahead and get the bouncer installed. So what I'll do is run sudo apt install crowdsec-firewall-bouncer-iptables. So I'll press enter, enter again, and now it's installing. Now next, we'll just make sure that CrowdSec and its bouncer are running and operational. So we'll type systemctl status and then CrowdSec, and we can see that it's running. And then next, we'll check the status of the bouncer. So system CTL status CrowdSec firewall bouncer. And we can see that it's running as well. So far, so good. I'll type Q to break out of here. And that's basically all we needed to do when it comes to the security side of things. Keep in mind that this is very basic security. You'll definitely want to make sure that you look even deeper into this. Again, I have other videos on that subject, but I just wanted to make sure that you received that mention. So back here on our server, what we're going to do is install the X2Go server component. So I'll show you that process. And to do that, we'll first need to add a brand new repository. So I'll run sudo and then add -apt-repository. And the repository that I'll want to add is /ppa:x2go and then /stable, just like that. That'll give us access to the repository that includes the server component that we'll be installing here on our cloud desktop server. So I'll press enter to confirm. And now the X2Go repository has been installed. And now that we have that repository here on our server, what we're going to do is install some packages from that repository. The first of which is going to be X2Go server. And then X2Go server -x session. So I'll press enter. It's going to install some required libraries as well. It may look like a lot, but those are just libraries, so nothing unusual there. I'll press enter. And there we go. When it comes to our cloud desktop server, we're all set. So what I'm going to do right now is show you how to connect to this particular server via an Ubuntu workstation. So I'll switch over to that computer, and then I'll be right back. Now the next thing that we're going to do is install the Mate desktop environment. And the reason why I chose the Mate desktop is because it's not only lighter weight, but it also runs very well in a remote session. And installing it is very easy. What we'll do is run sudo, and then apt install. And the package is the mate-desktop-environment package. And this is a meta package that will depend on a bunch of other packages that Mate will need in order to function. So I'll press enter. And as you can see, it's going to download 486 additional packages. That does seem like a lot, but it's totally okay. These are the packages that Mate needs to function. So I'll press enter to accept the default of yes. And I'll be right back as soon as it's done installing. And now it looks like it's all set. Now there's one more tweak that we'll need to add. And this is due to a bug that prevents some of the remote desktop functionality from working. So in order to avoid having you guys run into that same bug, I'm just going to give you the workaround right now. So what we'll do is edit a specific file. And it's in our home directory. And the file name is .profile. And what we'll do is go all the way to the very bottom of this file. We'll add a new line, and I'll just add a comment here so anyone else looking at this will know why I added this line. And then after that, I'll type the actual tweak. It's going to be consisting of the export command, or specifically, we're going to export dbus in caps, session underscore bus underscore address in all caps. We're going to set that equal to, in double quotes, Unix, colon, path, and then equals, $xdg in caps, underscore runtime in caps, underscore dir, and then forward slash, and then bus in lowercase. And that should be it. So we'll save the file, and then exit out. And now, actually, we should have everything ready to go when it comes to our remote desktop. All right, so here on my Ubuntu workstation, what I'm going to do is open up a terminal. And then what I'll do is run sudo apt install x2go and then client, just like that. So I'll press enter. Enter again. And that's all there is to it. So when I go to Activities and then I view the list of installed applications, we have the X2Go client right here. And here it is. So in order to connect to our cloud desktop from X2Go, we'll need to add our server here in this configuration. So I'll just name it Cloud Desktop, and then I'll paste in the IP address right here. The username, in my case, is going to be J. We have the ability to add an SSH key, so if you have one, feel free to add it right here. I'm just going to leave that blank just to keep this simple. Now down here, what we'll want to do is choose the session type that we want to have access to. In this case, we installed Mate, so I'll choose that. Now under connection, you could change this to whatever you think is appropriate, depending on your connection speed. I'm going to select WAN right here. If you crank this up too high and your connection can't support it, you might actually slow yourself down. If you're, you know, on the same network, you could choose LAN. I'm just going to choose WAN in my case. For the custom screen, I'm just going to bump this up a bit more. I'll give it an old school resolution of 1600 by 900 here. Anyway, I'll click OK, and let's give it a shot. Let's see what happens when I try to connect. So I'll click on it. I'll type in my super secret password here. And here we have a session. Now, this error right here does come up with Mate for some reason or another. I really don't understand why. It just means one of these panel applets have actually crashed. I'll just click Don't Delete. If it keeps coming up, you can delete it and try to re-add it. It shouldn't really actually make any difference whatsoever, though, so I'll just click Don't Delete. Leave that alone. Now, this window is very small. I'm using a computer that has a 4K display, so I probably should have chosen a higher resolution. You could tweak that in the settings for your session, but either way, we have an actual cloud desktop right here ready to go. I can go ahead and launch any application that I want, and of course I noticed that I don't have a web browser here. So in order to get a web browser, what I'll do is open up a terminal within the remote session here. And I'll also show you how to fix this ugly black border here in just a moment. But first of all, what I'll do is run sudo apt install and then Firefox. That way we'll have some sort of web browser that we can use within this session. And I should probably type the correct password. So it's going to install Firefox, so we'll have access to that. That's going to be very cool. All right, so now that that's taken care of, let's take care of this ugly border here. So here's how you do that. We'll click on the menu right here, and then we'll go down to Control Center. We're going to click on Windows, and then Compositing Manager, and we're going to disable this. And you'll notice that the horrible black border has gone away. So we've gone ahead and fixed that. Now the other thing I need to fix, obviously, is the resolution, since this window is very small, but that's going to depend on your particular machine, your native resolution, basically. So I'm going to leave that alone, but in the X2Go client session settings, that's where you can go to configure the resolution. But other than that, we have a cloud desktop right here. How cool is that? So there you go. You now have your very own cloud desktop. Isn't it great? In this video, I showed you how to set up the cloud desktop every step of the way. So if everything went well on your end, then that's exactly what you have right now, a cloud desktop. Now, did you find this video helpful? If you did, then please click that like button to let YouTube know that you found this video helpful, which might result in more Linux on YouTube, and I would really appreciate that. Either way, thank you so much for watching this video. I really appreciate it, and I'll see you in the next video.